I am delighted to welcome to the stage the Chancellor of the Exchequer, George Osborne, Professor Dame Nancy Rothwell of University of Manchester, and Bob Dudley of BP as well, who have come here this morning to Lancaster House to make a very exciting and potentially very important announcement about a new investment that's about to take place here in the UK. If I can invite them all up to the stage.
Over there. And hi, Bob. Well, good morning, everyone. I hope you've enjoyed the morning session. I hope you enjoy the conference we've laid on here at Lancaster House. This is actually my fourth visit to Lancaster House in about, I think Vince has probably been more times than me, but it has been a fantastic showcase for British business. And of course, today we are showcasing the energy sector. And I want to say something particular about BP and Manchester University. Before I do that, can I just say, I hope you are getting a strong impression today of how the UK can lead the world in the energy sector, securing investment, creating jobs, building that more prosperous future. And I think there is no better example of the significant contribution that this sector can make to the economy than the UK oil and gas industry. It is, has of course, been one of our great industrial success stories, supporting a third of a million jobs, extracting the equivalent of over 40 billion barrels of oil to date. And we recognise that companies operating in the North Sea work in a truly global market, and that we have to work hard to attract their capital and their jobs. We are committed to ensuring that these businesses continue to see the UK and the UK continental shelf as an attractive location for that investment, to making the most of our remaining oil and gas reserves, and to ensuring that the UK economy continues to benefit from the fruits of this remarkable industry. At this year's budget, I introduced an ambitious package of tax measures to encourage investment and innovation in the North Sea. We announced that we would end the uncertainty that has hung over the industry for years by introducing a contractual approach to oil and gas decommissioning. This will stimulate the market in North Sea assets, release billions of pounds of capital for further investment, and give companies the assurance they need to continue investing in mature fields. And the reaction from the industry, I know, has been a very, very positive one. We also announced in the budget changes to the field allowance regime to encourage investment in commercially marginal fields. That included a £3 billion allowance for large and deep fields to open up the west of Shetland, the last area of the basin that needs to be developed. And it's great to see the very important Rosebank project pressing ahead as a result of that. Building on this success, just last month we introduced a further allowance for large shallow water gas fields. And following this announcement, we have seen confirmation of the £1.4 billion investment in the Cygnus gas field. This will be the largest gas development in the southern North Sea in the past 25 years. And once in production, it's estimated that the field will deliver 5% of the UK's gas demand and contribute significantly to UK security of supply. It reinforces our commitment to gas as the biggest source of energy in the UK. And with 80% of the project's expenditure destined for UK companies, Cygnus is expected to create around 4,000 jobs in the UK. And indeed, today, as I speak, the companies involved have awarded contracts to a number of UK suppliers, including yards in Hartlepool and in Fife. These contracts alone will support over 1,000 jobs. And I am proud, as I know members of the government here are proud, that highly skilled supply companies such as these have developed a global reputation of excellence and expertise. We're proud that the UK is home to businesses that lead the world in cutting-edge research and technology. And we are committed to providing the best possible environment for investment in oil and gas, so we want the UK to continue as an open, competitive location as well for investment in electricity generation. We have an independently regulated market that welcomes investment from all over the world. This helps provide the UK with the expertise and the resources available around the world with a diverse and secure supply of power. We have a clear and stable investment regime, which allows investors to commit funds with confidence. The carbon price floor provides a clear cost trajectory for gas and coal generators. The new support rates announced for renewable technologies will ensure that low carbon generation remains affordable for consumers while providing certainty for investors. And last month, we made clear that we expect gas to continue to play a key role in meeting electricity demand for the UK throughout the 2020s and beyond. And we'll provide more detail in the autumn on the steps we will take to make the UK an even more attractive place for gas investors. Together, these policies will, we believe, enable billions of pounds of investment in the UK economy, creating jobs, securing the UK's position as a world leader in energy technology development. And this government is committed to ensuring the UK maintains its competitive edge in science and to putting innovation and research at the very heart of the growth agenda. And that's why top businesses such as BP are investing in the UK and supporting our world-leading universities in delivering cutting-edge research. And it gives me great pleasure today to welcome BP's announcement that it wishes to create an international centre for advanced materials. The fact that Manchester University won the competition, an international competition, to be the hub of this great project, and that two of the three spokes to the hub are at Cambridge University and Imperial College, clearly demonstrates, I think, to us all, the UK's strength in science and in innovation. The centre will play a key role in helping to maintain the world-leading status of the UK in the research of advanced materials. And I want to acknowledge publicly the substantial investment by BP in creating 25 new academic posts, 70 postgrad researchers, 50 postdoctoral fellows. I am actually an MP for the Manchester area, and as well as being an MP for the Manchester, that's not why they won the competition, by the way. I detected some cynicism there. But despite the fact I'm a local MP, they did incredibly well. And as the, also as, of course, the Chancellor, I'm absolutely delighted this investment will further strengthen Manchester and the northwest of England as a world-leading centre of expertise in materials technologies. It complements the £50 million investment to create a graphene global research and technology hub based in Manchester that we announced last year. And it will also strengthen other centres of materials expertise, such as the National Composite Centre in the Southwest and the Advanced Manufacturing Research Centre in Sheffield, which are working in partnership with global businesses such as Airbus, GKN, Rolls-Royce, and indeed Boeing. The UK's research base is second only to the US for the number of citations, and it is the most productive country for research in the G8 in citations and publications per pound of investment. Our research institutes include world-leading facilities that combine flexibility to pursue innovative research with a unique environment for developing outstanding students and early career researchers. Throughout the energy sector and indeed beyond, we are committed to creating an environment that allows research and innovation to flourish, ensuring that world-leading businesses, including energy businesses, continue to see the UK as an attractive location for investment. We are committed to harnessing that success to drive our economy forward. I hope you enjoy the conference today. We are here to help you invest in this country, here to hold your hand as you make that investment. There couldn't be a more attractive place to do business than the UK at the moment. So I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference. And let us welcome to the stage Bob Dudley, who's going to tell us more about the investment that BP is making. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chancellor, and thank you again for all being here this morning at the launch of ICAM. It is not the Prime Minister's personalized license plate. It stands for the International Center for Advanced Materials, and it is something we are very pleased to see getting underway. At the highest levels, as we talked about earlier before you were here, this is about developing a new generation of technologies for the energy industry. For oil rigs, for platforms, for drilling rigs, for refineries, for pipelines, for wind turbines, for developing products, for processing biofuels, and many other applications. These new technologies are absolutely vital, and let me tell you a little bit about why. We talked about some of this morning, but the starting point is, again, the global demand for energy, which is continuing to rise so rapidly. Last year, it grew at 2.5% a year, and on current trends, again, 40% growth by 2030. And the growth is coming mainly from emerging economies. Looking ahead, we all want to see a world where everyone has access to energy that is produced and consumed safely, efficiently, sustainably, and affordably. The mix will shift over time to lower carbon energies, no doubt, and fuels, but fossil fuels are set to remain the main source of energy for many decades now. Gas provides a cleaner alternative to coal for power generation and could make a massive difference in places like China, India, and Russia. Oil-based products do remain the most efficient transport fuels. That little hydrocarbon molecule is such an efficient bundle of energy, and automobile engines are likely to be twice as efficient by 2030 as they are today. And we believe renewables will grow faster than every other kind of energy. Our analysis suggests that there is enough energy resources to meet the demand, but the task of capturing and converting that resource into useful products cost-effectively is getting tougher and tougher. There are the resources in deep water, where the reservoirs can lie at over 6 miles below the seabed, with pressures and temperatures well beyond the scope of any current technology today. That's why we've launched a project called 20K, which stands for 20,000 pounds per square inch, to create the production technologies we need and the industry needs. And that's why we need ICAM to feed in projects such as 20K. So I think you'll see where I'm heading here. In order to keep the world's wheels turning, we need to go to new frontiers. And that's why we've decided to invest in a Center for Advanced Materials, a center that can help us and the entire industry develop the materials that are going to be needed to aid and produce energy in very, very demanding conditions. Our approach was to list out the specific areas of interest and then go in search of the world's best experts and the very best facilities in those disciplines. The six areas we wanted to cover were the structure of materials, what they're made of, such as alloys and ceramics, and secondly, smart coatings, which, for example, can protect against corrosion, heat. The third one was membranes, which are semi-porous materials like filters. Fourth, catalyst and energy harvesting to improve the efficiency of converting one form of energy to another. And fifth, functional materials, how they behave under various conditions. And sixth, energy storage. For example, to make available the power generated by wind turbines when the wind isn't actually blowing. The first of these three material structures, coatings, and membranes are our initial focus with ICAM. Then we conducted a global search, talked to a lot of very talented people around the world, focusing on those universities which already have strong relationships, and therefore we already have a very high level of trust. And we eventually decided to base the center at a place that seemed to us to have a unique concentration of both talent and facilities, and that's the University of Manchester. The team at Manchester have world-leading capability in areas such as metallic materials, anti-corrosion coatings, nanoscience, and materials chemistry. They also have world-class test facilities to see how these materials behave in very extreme conditions. And they have great expertise in monitoring equipment in situ to understand the process of corrosion and other damage. We're also aware of Manchester's prowess, as we support many research projects there already, including a dedicated laboratory in the science of corrosion. As you may know, Manchester's quality was highlighted 2 years ago when two of its experts won a Nobel Prize for their work on that advanced material that the Chancellor mentioned, graphene. In our selection process, Manchester's capability were very rigorously examined against other world-leading universities and institutions for their breadth of experience. It was clear to us that this was the place to go. We also think that no one university can possibly be world-leading at everything, especially in the field of advanced materials. And so we have asked Manchester to be the hub of a system similar to the one it has already set up with the Dalton Nuclear Institute. The spokes would be world-class teams at other universities, and we're framing agreements now with Cambridge, Imperial College here in London, and the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign in the U.S. as part of the ICAM system. These are universities with which we already work closely. For example, Illinois is part of our Energy Biosciences Institute. We will support the ICAM system with $100 million over 10 years. In addition to providing expertise on advanced materials, it will create jobs, including up to 100 posts of graduates and 80 postdoctoral fellows. It will become a center of expertise that the government can call upon, and I believe it will be an asset for Britain. As a company, BP is a global player. We have big investments in North America, continental Europe, and the emerging economies. But Britain remains our home. We are fortunate in that. Britain punches above its weight in research and development, I think, around the world. It has great world-class research capabilities attuned to the needs of business. That's why we spend around 40% of our R&D spending in the UK, roughly £400 million a year. As Sir Paul Nurse, the new president of the Royal Society, said in his Richard Dimbleby lecture, in the future, we will not be able to compete on the world stage with low labor costs or by exploiting vast reserves of mineral resources. We will have to compete with our brains and with our science. So that, I think, is a great opportunity for ICAM, for Manchester, a British-based research institute to design and develop materials for use all over the world in many industries. So thank you again for coming along today, Chancellor. And we will keep you posted on progress with the center. I'm pleased that we're deepening our relationship with Manchester, and we are very pleased to be embarking on this very new endeavor. And it gives me great pleasure to hand over to the President and Vice Chancellor of Manchester University, Dame Nancy Rothwell. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Chancellor, obviously I'm very proud to be here and delighted that the University of Manchester has won the centre of the ICAM. But I think this is a wider celebration. It's a celebration of British science and engineering. Universities in the UK are well recognised for their outstanding excellence in discovery. But we're often told that we're somewhat less adept at application and providing solutions for global challenges. Similarly, there are concerns that British industry may not be investing as much as some of us would like into research and development. The announcements today, I think, counter both of those concerns. The ICAM is particularly interesting because it is what we would call a truly interdisciplinary centre. It doesn't just build on strengths in one discipline, in engineering, but a breadth of expertise across several partners. In physics, chemistry, mathematics, and even in my own area of biology. Obviously, the focus is on oil and gas, but I think the applications and implications will be much wider for the energy sector as a whole, but indeed also for transport, construction, communications, and even for medicine. I was pleased to be able to present the achievements of UK life sciences and medicine to the Parliamentary Scientific Committee just a few weeks ago, achievements over the last 60 years. And it was interesting to reflect on how many of those achievements in medicine actually derived from engineering and advanced materials. The University of Manchester has a long history in materials and engineering since 1824, when the Manchester Institute was formed by local businessmen to provide training for young mechanics. And so it's appropriate that a key feature of the ICAM is training of the next generation of outstanding scientists and engineers. As Bob mentioned, we, like the other partners, have a long history of collaboration with BP. And I want to acknowledge the depth of that collaboration, not simply in the cutting-edge science, but in supporting undergraduates, interns, postgraduate students, and indeed in providing wider education in science. I'm delighted to be here on behalf of the University of Manchester, but want to thank my collaborators and colleagues, Professor Colin Bailey, who led the bid, and Professor Phil Withers, who will be the director of the new ICAM. And even I have to admit that the University of Manchester cannot alone provide the expertise that is required to solve these very challenging problems. And I'm delighted to be partnering with the universities of Cambridge, Imperial, and Illinois. As was mentioned, BP can choose to invest anywhere in the world and will do so. It should and does choose only the best, and I'm delighted that the best is largely in the UK. I'm sure that the ICAM will provide many exciting discoveries and solutions, some of which we all already know about, but I'm sure there will be others that, standing here today, we cannot even imagine. I'm delighted that we are part of that partnership and that it's so firmly embedded in British science and engineering. Thank you.